We're so glad you're here. Hey, can we give it up for everybody online? Let's give it up for the people watching with us online. Awesome. Well, my name is Devin Farney, and I am the executive pastor here at Elevate Church. My husband and I've been here for about 8 or 9 years. He's been here for 9 or 10 years. Who's keeping track? It's been a while. We love this church. It's our home church, and we get the privilege and honor to serve under the best pastors on the planet, pastors Brian and Danielle. Can we give them some love and some honor today? They are incredible. Now, I am a 90s baby. I am what is considered a millennial. Any other millennials in the house? Okay, there's a few of us. Yay! There's a few more than First Experience. That's amazing. Yes, a few millennials. Now, growing up, I loved the Olympics. Really into the Olympics. Anyone else like a big Olympics person? Like you get into it, you follow the news. A few of you. Okay. I have always been really into the Olympics. And if you are someone that likes a little drama and tension with your Olympics, this year has been a good one. It's been like a soap opera. And I love a good telenovela. So it has been a great Olympic season for me. And so the women's gymnastics, I'm sure if you are into it, you already know all about it. If you aren't into it, you've probably also heard about it and you're sick about hearing about it. So let's talk about it, shall we? Well, Simone Biles, the poster child of the Olympics, the poster child of it. Yes, she, big deal. She was going to break all these records and then the unthinkable happened. She withdrew from the team competition. It was a huge upset. She did it as the team competition was starting. She had already done her vault. It was this big thing. But there was a few really notable things when this happened for me. The first thing that was really cool to me was after the fact, so this team was like supposed to win gold. We've been winning gold in the all-team final the last few Olympics for women's gymnastics. It was a shoo-in. It was supposed to happen. That's what was going to happen. And they won silver. Big deal. Well, in the interviews that her team was doing, one thing that impressed me so much was that her teammates had the biggest smiles. We're still so grateful, so thankful, so happy to be wearing that silver medal around their necks. And all they did was talk about how amazing Simone was, how proud of her they were for her being honest about what she needed. And just the team camaraderie, the encouragement, the honor that they gave her was so big. But when this happened, I remember thinking, oh my goodness, I really hope that people are nice to Simone. I really hope this young lady that's only like 23, 24 years old doesn't get canceled. Because we live in this culture, right, where the minute you do something that someone doesn't like, the minute you disagree with something that someone doesn't like, you get your spot gets blown up, as the kids say. You get canceled. People talk about you. They say terrible things about you on the internet. And I was like, man, I hope this young woman, who's still a young woman, she's an adult, but I mean like 24, that's not even that grown. And so I was just like, man, I hope that that doesn't happen to her. I hope it doesn't. And it didn't. For the most part, it's been pretty positive. It's opened the door to a lot of really great conversations about mental health and about athletes and all of these amazing things. But the other thing that stood out to me when this happened was when you watch the team competition, that as it's happening and she tells her team, you can kind of see her telling them that she's sorry, she's gonna step out. The very next thing she says to them is, do you need anything? How can I help you? Immediately, she wants to serve them. Now, in her head, she was probably thinking, oh my goodness, what have I done? Everyone's gonna be mad at me. I'm gonna lose money. I'm gonna lose sponsorships. I'm gonna have to answer all of these questions because she has been the poster child of this year's Olympics. But she puts all that to the side. She makes a decision that's the best for herself, and she immediately turns to her team and say, hey, how can I help you? How can I set you up to success? I know I can't be in it myself, but how can I honor you? And that was so big because I think so often we think, oh, our culture has become so negative. We're in this big cancel culture. But it reminded me that honor is still a big value, not just for Jesus followers, but for everyone. Honor is still here. Honor is still important, and honor is still being carried out even in the Olympics. And I thought that that was so good, because the thing is, when I first started coming to Elevate, that was something we always talked about. That's something we still always talk about. A big value for Elevate Church is honor, showing people honor. And honor can be hard, but in Romans 12:10, it says, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. We are called to honor people above ourselves. Now, I think honor sometimes can be a little bit of a scary word. It can be a very formal word, a very big word, that it always makes me think of like kings and queens and how we're supposed to roll out the red carpet and do all these things to show honor. And while honor is a formal sounding word, it's not as complicated as it sounds. Honor means to value someone, to show someone that they matter, to show someone that they're important in this world. That's what honor is. Actually, honor is closely related to love. So if you don't know exactly how to honor, the best place to start is, well, how do you show someone love? Because if you show someone love, you're probably pretty close to showing someone honor. Even in this verse, it says, be devoted to one another in love. The next word, honor one another above yourselves. Even in this verse, they're next to each other. So if you aren't sure where to start when it comes to honor, start with, how do you show people love? Start there. That's the best place to start if you don't know how. But sometimes we can slip in to what I would call withholding honor. Sometimes instead of showing honor, if we aren't quite sure, if we feel like, oh, maybe they aren't really the most honorable person, I'm not going to dishonor them, but maybe I'll just withhold my honor a little bit. But the reality is withholding honor is the same as dishonoring someone. So withhold honor is to dishonor someone. It's to make someone feel common, to make someone feel unimportant, to make someone feel like they don't really have value. And whether we mean to or not, withholding honor can do just as much damage as dishonoring someone. Something our pastors say that I love is that you're not gonna become the person that you could be by someone constantly telling you what you aren't. So if you continue to tear someone down and tell them what they aren't, to make them feel unimportant, to make them feel bad, to talk about them publicly and privately in a negative way, if you continue to do that, yeah, they're probably gonna slip into that dishonorable person that you think they are. But if you consistently build somebody up, encourage them, honor them, show them they have value, show them that they matter, if you continue to do that, they're gonna step in to that honorable person that you believe that they can be. And the other thing about honor is that honor is different from respect. See, because respect is something that is earned. Respect is something that you earn when you've built up equity with somebody. But honor is something that is given. You don't have to do something to get honor. Honor is something that you should give freely to people. And so it's easy to slip into this, well, they haven't earned it. No. Respect is earned. Honor is given. Now, you can respect someone that you honor. It's good to respect people that you honor. But you don't have to respect someone to honor someone. You can give someone honor. You can value someone. You can say that someone matters without fully respecting the person. But if you continue to honor them, you continue to take steps to give them honor, to encourage them, I think over time you'll find that you do respect that person, because they'll begin to step in to that honorable position. They'll begin to step in to be someone worthy of honor. And there's no better example of this than in the Bible. The Bible is filled with stories, with verses all about honor. And one of my favorites is about a guy named Saul. In 1 Samuel, it talks about this man named Saul, King Saul. And the people wanted a king. And so God gave them a king, and that king was Saul. And at first, Saul seemed like the right guy for the job, but over time, King Saul began to disobey God. He began to sin against God. He began to show that he was not a guy after God's own heart, which is what God was looking for. So God decided he needed to appoint a a new king. So he went out and he found David. Now, just because he knew that David was the next king and appointed him didn't mean that David just became king. That's not how it happened. There was a lot of time in between there. And so at first he appointed David as king, and it says in 1 Samuel 16:13, the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. Now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a harmful spirit from the Lord tormented him. And so David now had God's favor. He had the Spirit of the Lord on him. God was with him. And it had left Saul. But Saul was still king at this point. And so a little time later, David began to have different things happen. He was able to defeat the Philistine Goliath. This was a big deal. And after this happened, people took note of David. People began to look at David as a big deal, as someone to honor, someone to respect, someone to look up to. And King Saul did not like this. King Saul could already feel that God was not with him anymore. And he began to grow very, very jealous of David. So jealous that in 1 Samuel 18:10, it says, the next day, a harmful spirit from God rushed upon Saul. He raved within his house while David was playing the lyre, as he did day by day. Saul had his spear in his hand, and Saul hurled the spear, for he thought, I will pin David to the wall. But David evaded him twice. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him, but had departed from Saul. So Saul removed him from his presence and made him a commander of thousands. And he went out and came in before the people. And David had success in all of his undertakings, for the Lord was with him. And when Saul saw that he had great success, he stood in fearful awe of him. So King Saul threw literal spears at David. Now we all have people that are in authority of us, but I have never had a boss or a government official or anybody throw a physical spear at me, right? David had spears thrown at him. But the thing that is the most notable to me about all of this is that David didn't leave. He continued to honor King Saul. He continued to be under his authority. After this man had thrown spears at him, had treated him terribly, was not a good leader, was not a good king, but David knew that he was called to be under authority of King Saul. He knew that that is where God had him for a reason. Now, eventually, David did leave. After King Saul had made this plan to kill him, David got word of this. And so David left, but he left quietly. He left in the night. He didn't bring a bunch of people with him. He didn't tell everybody what was happening. No, he left quietly. And then David even got a chance to kill King Saul. He could have killed him. But instead what he did was he chopped off a piece of King Saul's robe. He chopped it off and he showed it to him to tell him, hey, I had the chance to kill you, but I didn't. And as soon as David had finished speaking these words to Saul, Saul said, is this your voice, my son David? And Saul lifted up his voice and wept. And he said to David, you are more righteous than I, for you have repaid me good, whereas I have repaid you evil. And you have declared this day how you have dealt well with me, and that you did not kill me when the Lord put me into your hands. For if a man finds his enemy, will he let him go away safe? So may the Lord reward you with good for what you have done to me this day. And now behold, I know that you shall surely be king, and that the kingdom of Israel shall be established in your hand. Now there's a lot more to this story. I encourage you to read this story, because the life of David is one of the most fascinating stories in the Bible, in my opinion. But we'll stop there for now. But the thing that I love about this story that stands out so much is that David continued to honor, even when he had a chance to dishonor, even when he had a chance to kill someone that had literally tried to kill him multiple times. David continued to show honor. He continued to step into that. He continued to be under Saul's authority. And even when he had the chance to leave, he did it quietly. He did it without making a fuss, without telling everybody. No, he did it quietly, respectfully, and with honor. And that's the kind of person I want to be. I want to be someone that honors in every situation I possibly can. And something we say around here at Elevate is to honor up, honor down, honor all around. So what does that look like practically? It's a fun saying. It's fun to say. It's easy to remember. But what does that look like? Well, to honor up, the Bible is very clear about who we honor up to. The first person is God. We honor God. That one seems easy enough, right? God, I can do that. Yeah, I love God. How do we do that? Well, practically, we honor God's name. We don't use it in vain. We use it with honor. We use it with respect. We don't use it as if it's a curse word or it's a bad thing to say. No, we use God's name with honor. It shows God honor when we do that. The second thing is God's day, the Sabbath. We honor God's day. We come to church. We go have a big brunch with your family. You spend time just talking, connecting, loving on each other. You don't have a big list of to-dos. Now, your Sabbath doesn't have to be a Sunday. It's just picking a day to rest, a day to pause, a day to spend time with God and just rest in your Sabbath. Take care of yourself. We honor God when we do that. The next one is giving to God first. Not waiting till the end of the month, till all the bills are paid and then hoping we have enough, but giving God our first and our best. When we do that, we're showing honor to God. We're showing him that we honor him, we value him. He matters to us. He's first in our lives. We honor with our worship. We honor by giving God our best when we worship. Oftentimes in worship, you'll see people raise their hands when we're doing that. When I raise my hands, it's as if to say, God, I love you. I need you. I need more of you. I honor you. So when you feel comfortable, raise your hands. Honor him with your worship. Lift your voice. Because worship is an overflow of our hearts. It's an outpour of what's in our hearts. The next thing is to honor our parents. So that's how we honor God. But to honor our parents. Exodus 20:12 says, honor your father and mother. Then you will live a long, full life in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Now, when you're younger, when you're living under your parents' roof or whoever is the parental figure for you, maybe it's your foster parents, your step parents, your grandparents, whoever it is for you, you honor your parents. The Bible's very clear about this. When you're living under their roof, you obey. You do what they say, you do it right away. Those are some of the things we say in eKids. I love them. They're very catchy. You can use them. Write them down for your kids. They're helpful. But we obey. We do what our parents ask, and we do it right away. But when you're older, I feel like this is something, as I've gotten older, as I've had my own kids, honoring my parents looks a little bit different when I'm no longer in the house anymore, when I no longer am living under my parents' roof. And one thing that I've learned with my mom and I, when I was in high school, my mom and I went toe-to-toe. We would fight a lot because we both have very strong personalities. We both always think we're right. And we're both, we both have executive leadership. Now, some people might say bossy. I think that word's a little rude. I don't think it has a lot of honor. So I prefer executive leadership. But my mom and I both have strong personalities. But as I've grown older, my mom and I are best friends. We're really close. But there are still times my mom has a lot of opinions, a lot of thoughts. But what I've learned as I've gotten older, the best way I can show my mom honor, even when I don't agree, even when I don't want to take her opinion or her advice, she doesn't actually care if I take her advice. She doesn't care if I listen to her opinion. What she cares about is she wants to know that she still has a place in my life. She wants to know that she still matters. And so if you're struggling with that today, if you're struggling with a relationship with your parents, oh, they always try to tell me what to do. I'm grown. I don't need to listen. Hey, I would encourage you. Do your parents know that they still matter to you? Do your parents know that they still have a place in your life? Maybe they aren't the number one person you go to for advice. That's okay. It's okay if they aren't the people that you go to for every single thing. But man, let them know that you care about them. Invite them for dinner every once in a while. Give them a call weekly. Check on them. Let them know that you still care about them and that they still have an important place in your life. That's one of the best ways you can honor your parents. once you're no longer in their house. It's so important. And the next part of honoring up is to honor authority. Romans 13:1 says, everyone must submit to governing authorities, for all authority comes from God, and those in positions of authority have been placed there by God. Now, this is a tough one, because oftentimes the people in governing authorities are bosses we don't agree with. They make bad decisions sometimes. They're not perfect people, but none of us are. And so it's hard. How do we honor in that situation? The first thing that I would tell you is, hey, you can disagree with someone and still honor them. You can disagree with someone in leadership and authority over you, and you can still show them honor. If you're struggling, I know I have a friend right now that is really struggling, some people in this church, with a decision that their job is making, and they're having a hard time honoring from that place. But the first thing I tell you, if you don't even know how to honor because you're so frustrated, you're so mad, is focusing on not dishonoring. First, just try not to dishonor them, because if you focus on trying not to dishonor them, you'll get closer and closer to honoring them. And one of the best ways to focus on not dishonoring someone is to not talk about them publicly or privately. Don't talk negatively about them. You don't have to talk positively about them either. Just don't talk about them. Don't talk about them at all. My mom always said, if you don't have something nice to say, don't say it at all. When it comes to trying to show honor or to try not to dishonor someone, that's a great principle to live by. But don't dishonor them publicly or privately. Keep that to yourself. Don't talk badly about them, and pray for them. Pray that they get people around them that can be good, that can speak life into them, that can give them good wisdom. Pray for that. Pray for it regularly. And I believe your heart might start to soften towards that person. Now, you may never agree with them, and that is okay, but you can still honor someone that you don't agree with. Because the thing about honor is, it says way more about you than it does about the person that you're trying to honor. Honor's not for them. Honor is about you. It reveals what's in your heart. So be careful how you honor, because it says a lot more about you as a person than it ever will about the person you're trying to honor. And the last part of honoring up is to honor pastors and spiritual leaders. In 1 Timothy 5:17, it says, the elders who direct the church, the affairs of the church well, are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is preaching and teaching. Now, this is something that, man, it's easy to know that we need to honor our church leaders, but sometimes it can be hard because, again, we don't always agree. But let me tell you, pastors, lead pastors of church, have a responsibility that we will never understand. They carry a weight that even me, as someone on staff, I will never understand the weight that our pastors, their family feels. I'll never fully understand that. We'll never fully understand what they have to carry. And the Bible's very clear about giving them double honor, about honoring them. Hey, that looks like, again, not saying bad things, encouraging them, letting them know when they have a message that really touches your heart that made a difference for you. Tell them, encourage them. Yeah, can we honor our pastors, church? 10 seconds. Tell them how much you love them. We have the best pastors on the planet. Come on, give it up for them. That's right. And that also is applied to kids leaders, student leaders. Man, the people that are caring for your kids, love them double. Give them double honor, because being a kids director, overseeing kids and students, is hard work. Love those people. Give them an extra gift card at Christmas. Bake them some extra cookies. But thank them, love them, and honor them double. And that means too, when you get to a place, and this goes with bosses, churches, all of it, if you're at a place where you feel like, hey, I've got to leave, I just can't be here anymore, I don't want this job anymore, hey, I'm not going to be at this church anymore, I want to encourage you to make sure that you thank them. Even if you're hurt, there's been some scarring, whatever that looks like, hey, thank them. Thank them for what they have done for you. One of the best ways that you can honor someone, even when you're ready to walk away from whatever that may look like, one of the best ways you can honor up is to thank them. And if you've recently left somewhere and you didn't thank those leaders that were in your life, hey, I want to encourage you. Reach out to them, write them a letter, text them, send them an email, whatever you want to do. But just thank them. Say, hey, thank you for being someone that cared about me for a season. Hey, thanks for being in my life. Thanks for the opportunity you gave me. Because when we do that, it shows honor. And it shows that we valued them and we care for them. You may not agree with them. You may be hurt. But hey, I think one of the best ways to heal hurt is to honor. One of the best ways when you're not feeling it is to honor, is to put someone above yourself. So that's how we honor up. How do we honor down? Well, if you aren't sure how to honor down, look at the life of Jesus. Jesus's life, the New Testament, is filled with ways that Jesus honored people. Everything Jesus did on earth, he showed honor. He cared for people that he was leading. He cared for people that were dishonorable. He cared for people that were not perfect people. And he went out of his way to outdo others in honor. He shows us that. And whether you are a parent or you have a job or you just have a group of friends, you have a sphere of influence, which means you are a leader in some way. You are a leader. You may not think of yourself as a leader, but you are, which means that you lead people, that you have people that you can honor down to. And so that can look like your kids, parents. Teach your kids how to honor. Do that by modeling it for them. Honor your kids. Speak life over your kids. Tell them what they are. Tell them how great they are. Not what they are not, but what they are. Speak life over your kids. And as you model honor, they will begin to receive that. Because the thing is if you have kids now that aren't honoring you, they're not gonna honor their future boss. They're not gonna honor their teachers. They're not gonna honor the people around them. So teach them the value of honor. Teach them the why of honor. We need kids that fully understand honor and that can go out into the world and show honors to others. That's what we need right now. So teach your kids about honor now before it becomes a bigger issue. It's all about honor. That's right. And with the people that you lead, I think sometimes I've heard people complain of, oh, they just don't respect me. They don't give me honor. I feel like no one cares what I have to say as a leader. But the first question that I would ask you is, what do you do to show honor to those that you lead? Because most likely, the reason you're not getting the results you want is because you are not honoring people with the honor that you expect to receive back. You are not honoring people the way that you want to be honored. And maybe you are, but most likely, that's where I would start, is start showing honor, encouraging people. When you have people that show up and go out of their way to do their job really well, text them, tell them, encourage them, give them gift cards, love on them, however you can show it, show it. And if you weren't sure exactly how to honor, ask yourself, how do I show love? It's not that different. Encourage them, care about them, and show them they matter. That's all anybody really wants anyway. Everyone wants to matter. No one wants to feel like they aren't important. No one wants to show up to their job and feel like what they did was wasteless, that it was useless. No, they want to feel like it was valued. So thank them, tell them that they matter and that you value the time that you gave them. So we honor up, we honor down. And the third thing is we honor all around. How do we show honor to those around us? Well, one of the hardest parts for me sometimes is to show honor to my spouse. Now, that sounds silly because we know that, obviously. Yeah, we should honor our spouse. We should show them love. We should encourage them. We should speak life. Those are all really easy things to say. But often for me, when I'm at my most stressed out, when I'm at my most frustrated, the number one person I want to take it out on is the person that's close to me. Because I know he's going to forgive me. I know he's going to care about me. But over time, that can be really, really damaging on a relationship, on a marriage. And so I want to ask you, how are you honoring your spouse? For me and Brian, we are a little different when it comes to the cleanliness of our house. I am someone that has a spot for everything. I don't like clutter. Clutter stresses me out more than anything. I am the mom that resets my baby's toys before bed. I know it's ridiculous. I know she's just gonna throw them everywhere, but it just helps me be able to sleep. And so I like everything in its spot. My husband, on the other hand, he doesn't really understand spots for things. He's more of like, yeah, it's on the counter. That's where it belongs. And I'm like, no, the counter's supposed to be clean. So we see a little differently on that. But over the last year or so, Brian has become really, really intentional about trying to be better about putting things in his spots. He calls himself a good cleanup Brian now. He said, no, I'm a good cleanup Brian now. I put things in their spots. And if you know my husband, you can picture him saying that and it makes you chuckle because it is funny. And so he now is way more intentional about that because he knows that it's important to me, that it matters to me. But at first, when he was starting to get better at this, I was still so focused on all the things he wasn't doing, and I kept telling him, ugh, no, you're still not doing this. Oh, why is this way? And it just consistently hurt his feelings because he was trying so hard to do those things. He was trying so hard to go out of his way to honor me, to care about me, to show that he valued the things that I valued, but I continuously dishonored him, and I didn't mean to. But now I try to be a lot more intentional about calling out the good things. I try to brag on him more than I nag on him. I try to tell him the things that he's doing that are good, that are better, which again seems like such a simple thing, but when you're in it and you're frustrated and you had a long day at work or whatever's going on, it's a lot easier to tell someone what they aren't than to tell someone what they are and what they could be. And so when it comes to honor, the best way we can honor our spouse, our friends, our pastors, leader, anybody, is to tell them what they are and speak into them what they could be, what you see and what God sees, to tell them who they are. Because at the end of the day, how you honor reveals what's really in your heart. It reveals what's inside. Romans 12:10, another version says, love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. We should outdo one another with honor. Honor so good. Because ultimately, we don't want to just be someone that honors, but we want to be someone that's honorable. I want to be someone that people want to honor. Not that they feel forced to honor because someone at church told them they had to. I want to be someone that's honorable. I want to be someone that people want to honor, that want to be like. Someone that's Jesus-like, because ultimately, we want to be more like Jesus. And one of the best ways we can be like Jesus is to honor. Well, after the London Olympics in 2012, there was a race in December in Spain. And there were two runners. There was Ivan Anya, who was a Spanish runner, and a Kenyan runner, Abel Matai. And these two runners were running, and because they were runners, so they run. And so when they did that, Matai was about 10 meters from the finish line. And he got confused and stopped. He thought that he had crossed the finish line. He thought the race was over. And Ivan Anya saw this, and he had a choice. He could either blow past him and win the race, or he could do the honorable thing and he could get him to cross the finish line. Now it was fair and square because technically, Matai stopped. Anya could have kept going and could have won and no one would have said anything. They wouldn't have said he cheated or anything like that because he would have won fair and square. But instead, he motioned to Matai and helped push him over the finish line. And people were baffled by this because they were so confused why someone would do that. I mean, he could have won this race. And so after reporters were swarming Anya and asked him, why did you do this? Why did you let Matai win? And he said, I didn't let him win. He was gonna win. It was his race to win. what would be the merit of my victory? What would be the honor of this medal? What would my mother think of it? Because at the end of the day, how we choose to honor people says more about us. It reveals what's in our hearts. So if there's people in your life that are hard to honor, it's not about them. That's not why we honor. We don't honor for their benefit. We honor to reveal what's in our heart and the kind of person that we want to be. If we want to be more like Jesus, we have to outdo one another in honor. And ultimately, we honor because we know the honorable one. God sent his son Jesus, not because we deserved it, not because we were honorable. We're dishonorable, full of sin. We make mistakes. We're not perfect. But Jesus is. And that's why he sent his son, that's why God sent his son Jesus to die for us. And when he did that, he wiped away our sin. He died for our sin, he died for our shame, so that we could strive to be honorable. And if you're ready to make that decision today, we're gonna pray, and I wanna encourage you, if you're ready to join God's family, to come home, you're invited. Everyone has a seat at God's table. Everyone has a seat in God's family. Let's pray. God, I thank you for today. I thank you for every person online in the house today. We're ready to start living for you, God. We're ready to step away from our life of sin, shame, mistakes. We're ready to step into what you have for us, God. You sent your son Jesus to die for us. We're ready to start living a life for you, one that is honorable, one where we can be more like Jesus. Give us a brand new clean heart, God. It's in your name we pray. And if you prayed that prayer, would you just slip up your hand right now? Thank you. God sees you. God, help us to be more honorable. Help us to honor others. Help us to outdo one another in honor. Help us to be more like you each and every day, God. We love you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.